Good Sunday morning, Northeast Ohio, and what is now day 30 of this government shutdown. Border security, of course, the central issue in this standoff. And since many of you have been posting pictures to Facebook over the course of the past week of how you've aged or didn't age, we thought we would do the same with our elected leaders. Not how they've aged, but how they have evolved when it comes to the issue of border barriers. More than a decade ago, Washington debated the merits of the Secure Fence Act of 2006, authorizing the construction of 700 miles of fencing along the U.S.-Mexico border.
The bill before us will certainly do some good. It will authorize some badly needed funding for better fences.
Then Senator Barack Obama, among those speaking on the floor in favor of it, while fellow Illinois Democrat Dick Durbin wondered if it went far enough.
Consider just the obvious. Our southern border is more than 2,000 miles long, and we are building 300 or 700 miles worth of fencing or barriers? Well, I have to say that that leaves a lot of area uncovered.
Senator Obama would vote for the bill, as would Senator Schumer and Clinton and 23 other Democrats, as it passed 80-19. 7 years later, it would come up again as part of a bigger border security bill, again calling for 700 miles of fencing, and again passing with the support of Democrats like Ohio Senator Sherrod Brown, while Republicans like Rob Portman and John Cornyn of the border state of Texas opposed it.
Adding 20,000 Border Patrol agents, assuming that it ever actually happens, and a few hundred miles of additional fencing could turn out to be a massive waste of taxpayer dollars.
So what's changed in 2019? Nothing, says Dick Durbin.
Democrats believe in border security. We do not believe in government shutdowns as a threat to innocent federal workers and as a tool for the president to use over and over again to pressure Congress.
Voting for the Secure Fence Act of 2006 was then Ohio Senator Mike DeWine, who told me this week that he hopes this mess in Washington gets resolved now. It was a busy week for DeWine, who on Monday stood before his son, State Supreme Court Justice Pat DeWine, and next to his wife Fran, holding a stack of 9 Bibles, and took the first of 2 oaths, making him the state's 70th governor. DeWine then wasting no time in attempting to tackle a major issue facing the state, GM's decision to close the Lordstown Assembly Plant. News 5 was the only local station to travel with the governor and lieutenant governor to Detroit on Wednesday. They toured the North American International Auto Show, meeting with other Ohio automakers. Then Thursday morning, meeting with GM CEO Mary Barra. DeWine telling me after their meeting, the pitch was simple. GM is looking to add 20 new electric vehicles to their roster in coming years. Why not have one of them produced in Lordstown?
If they will put a new line in Lordstown, that we will do everything that we can to support that, help that, put a package together.
Before this week, it was former Governor John Kasich who was leading the talks with GM. Before he left office, he told me his sense was not good that GM would be willing to do that.
Are they going to have another car, another vehicle there? I don't really think they will. It's a Hail Mary pass, to be honest with you.
In my last conversation with Governor Kasich a week ago, he felt that a new line would be a Hail Mary. Do you get a sense of that more after meeting with Mary?
Well, I will simply say this. She did not rule that out, but I had no indication that this is going to happen. I mean, I did not get any indication that they would be able to put a new line in. Didn't say no, but certainly gave us no indication that was going to happen.
And if they don't bring a new line in, DeWine did get a sense that GM would be willing to work with the state to fill the plant with another company.
They're going to do everything that they can to get somebody else in there. I am convinced of that. I think it's in their selfish interest to do it. It's in the interest of Mahoning Valley. It's in the interest of the state of Ohio.
GM has offered little hope to the union representing the roughly 1,500 workers at the plant, yet they remain hopeful.
I don't know that we're going to get any commitment today or tomorrow or this week. I think we're still going to end up closing down in March for a period of time. But I've got a lot of confidence in our negotiating team up north, the International UAW, and I believe the corporation will sit down. We just want the company to know that Lordstown is ready for the future. Whatever they got, give it to us and we'll do it.
Now, GM has said their focus as new electric lines come to be will be to add work to existing plants that are currently operating below capacity. Well, today is January 20th, designated by the Constitution as every 4 years, Inauguration Day. So the question is, 2 years from today, who will be raising their right hand? And might it be for the first time since Warren Harding in 1920, an Ohioan? Ohio Senator Sherrod Brown dipping his toe into the waters to test the temperature. Brown announcing this week he's launching a Dignity of Work tour that will kick off at the end of the month in Cleveland before taking him to Iowa and the early primary states of New Hampshire, Nevada, and South Carolina.
I want to continue to learn about the dignity of work from everybody, from whether you swipe a card, whether you punch a clock, whether you work for tips, whether you work on salary, whether you're taking care of kids. And I want to hear from people around, and I want this conversation and this dignity of work tour to encourage my colleagues running for president that this should be the narrative. If you fight, it's the best way to govern, fighting for the dignity of work, and it's the best way to win elections.
With Democracy 2019, I'm John Kosich. Enjoy your Sunday.